welcome.
Good morning, committee members and esteemed guests. My name is Felicity Maxwell. I'm a Travis County resident living in Austin, City of Austin, District 5, and a proud AISD parent. I'm delighted to be here today to speak with you all as you come together to address the critical issues facing our community. And of course, the most challenging issue facing Austin and Travis County right now is the financial well-being of our school districts, specifically Austin AISD. As you heard in the as you will hear in the presentation regarding Austin AISD Proposal A, Proposition A, our schools are facing tremendous financial hardship. While support and passage of Prop A in November will help to address part of that problem, we know that because of politics and inaction at the Texas legislature, school districts have wider budget shortfalls that cannot be alleviated through simple tax increases. To help work through these complex issues, Austin AISD has created an ad hoc budget committee, bringing together parents, teachers, staff, administration, and community leaders to carefully examine how Austin AISD budget, how the Austin AISD budget works, and where, if possible, reductions can be made. I'm proud to be a member of this committee and appreciate the hard work and dedication of everyone involved in this process. But I have some bad news. The cuts needed to keep our school district running are extreme, and the options as to where to make those cuts are limited. Specifically, we have heard that making cuts to classroom learning, support staffing, and critical support student support should be a last resort. As a parent of two AISD students, I agree. In Austin, we value strong public education, and that includes things like well-stocked school libraries with professional librarians, on-site nurses and health professionals for our campuses, and educational specialists who provide essential learning supports. I know you as elected officials, school board trustees, city council members, and county representatives, you share these Austin values and want to see our K-12 population thrive, which means we need your help. We know that AISD, City of Austin, and Travis County have a strong partnership. In this time of great need, we are asking our city and county friends to do more, to do as much as possible. We know that there are opportunities for additional financial supports across a variety of programs and at different levels of government. For example, we appreciate Councilmember Velasquez and his ongoing championing of the parent support specialists and the critical role they play in our school communities. Likewise, we're excited to see Travis County's expanded efforts around childcare and the new opportunities it opens up for our 0-3 families. But I'm here to ask you all to do even more, to take on additional financial responsibilities where possible, and particularly where AISD has been on the front line of our shared communities. We are asking for financial support for our nursing and health professionals on campus who provide essential frontline care to students and families. For our new to Austin immigrant families who often turn to the district to help them navigate a myriad of city and county logistics as they settle into our communities with their school-aged children. The opportunities for partnership are many, and we hope to soon have a comprehensive list of financial opportunities to share with you all as our county and city representatives. In the meantime, I'll leave you with the wise words from our superintendent, Segura: stronger schools make for a stronger Austin. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Maxwell. Were there any other speakers? Just the one? Okay, thank you. So we will now move to item number 2, approval of the minutes from the June 10th meeting. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Trevelyan, seconded by Councilmember Ryan Alter. If there are no objections, we will approve the minutes. So our next item, I'm pleased to introduce you to our new city manager, T.C. Brodnix. Mr. Brodnix started with the City of Austin in May of this year, bringing more than 30 years of municipal government experience with him. He served as an assistant city manager in both Pompano Beach, Florida, and San Antonio, Texas. Was the city manager of Tacoma, Washington for 5 years, and most recently the city manager of Dallas, Texas for 7 years. He is here today to introduce himself to this committee and allow us the opportunity to get to know him. We're very lucky here at the City of Austin to have Mr. Brodnix be our new city manager, and I will now turn it over to City Manager Brodnix.
Thank you, Councilwoman Alter, and good morning, I think, to everyone here. I just appreciate the opportunity to be a part of and sit and listen for a few minutes to the dialogue and the issues, I think, that cross all of our jurisdictions and our organizations. And I think partnerships like this and this subcommittee, I think, are important to ensuring that not just the elected officials that are represented today, but also the staff that support them are working across organizations to do things for and the benefit of the folk that we jointly serve. And so, again, I'm just glad to be the city manager here, looking forward to continue learning and partnership with not just the school district, but also the county, as well as continue to work with our city council to support all the efforts that cross our jurisdiction. So thank you, and thank you for having me this morning.
Thank you, City Manager. Why don't we have the members of our committee who are not on the city council just take a minute to introduce themselves, and if you want to say anything particular to City Manager, feel free to do that. President Singh.
Yes. Hello. Nice to meet you again. We met very briefly when you first came on board, but I'm Aarti Singh. I'm the board president for Austin ISD, and I really look forward to continuing working with you and your team as we continue to make Austin an amazing place for our kids and for our families. Thank you.
Ophelia, would you like to go next?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
Good morning. My name is Ophelia Maldonado Zapata. I am AISD District 2 trustee. I too look forward to working with you, even though this is my last term. I will still be visiting you. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Nolita Lugo. I am the Place 8 at one of the other at-large trustees with Austin ISD. I'm also in my final term, thankfully still find ways to be engaged. So I'm looking forward to all the great work that this subcommittee will continue to do, and of course the collaboration. And I just wanted to appreciate the public comment from earlier. Thank you.
Mr. Trevelyan.
My name is Jeff Trevelyan. I am the county commissioner of Precinct 1, which is the northeastern quadrant of Travis County, which, as you probably know, has historically been underserved. So I look forward to working with you. Your reputation precedes you. We are proud of the work that you've done and are looking forward to the work that we will continue to do as a community. So thank you for your commitment to the area. And if we can be helpful in any way, our doors will always be open to you.
And then our non-city staff who support our committee, if you want to introduce yourselves as well, that'd be great.
Hello, City Manager. Right next, Pilar Sanchez. I'm the County Executive over Health and Human Services. We met before, and I'm welcome to Travis County.
Thank you, and then I'm not, Edna, would that be you? And then last but not least, we have Commissioner Bridget Say. Did you want to just say anything to City Manager Broadnecks before we move on?
Yeah. Nice to re-meet you. I was at the meet and greet in the chambers.
I think you need to push it on.
Bridget Shea, Travis County Commissioner, Precinct 2. Nice to see you.
Well, thank you. You're welcome to join us for however long you're able, and grab an extra lunch on your way out. We appreciate you being here. This joint subcommittee is an opportunity for us as members of the City Council, the Commissioner's Court, and the trustees to come together to learn about what each other is doing, to support one another in different ways. The work with the childcare initiative comes out of work that we've done in this subcommittee in the past. They've done some work on housing. We're looking also at some mental health issues and just generally being able to support each other as we go into the legislative session and to make sure that we have awareness when there are challenges such as we're going to talk about today that AISD is facing with respect to the state, so we have a place to have those conversations. So if there are no further questions or comments for the city manager or colleagues, did any of you want to add anything?
Just super brief, if I may. Since I know the city manager is busy, don't know if you'll be here for item number 6, the budget for AISD, but just kind of echoing the comments that were made by the speaker, you know, I know we as a community are facing a real challenge with the largest school district in this area. Even if Prop A does go forward, there will still be shortfalls and really hard decisions that will have to be made. And, you know, I think we as a city are often, we get asked to do a lot of things that aren't necessarily in the city portfolio, but that is not unique to us. I know the school districts are also asked to be public health providers, asked to step into a lot of roles after school and even be emergency shelters that I think we can, as a city, potentially better work with the district and identify areas where we might work better together and potentially co-fund things or just be able to explore over the next, I think, year or so how we might take that relationship one step further and really work with the district to identify opportunities, whether it's from a taxing scheme or whatnot, to really make it so that we are supporting each other and ultimately supporting the kids. I'm lucky enough to have two kids in AISD as well, so this is near and dear, and I know that kids are a big priority of yours, and so just want to highlight that before we continue on, and I think it's going to be a long-term discussion, but AISD needs our help a little bit right now, so we want to be here.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Just to speak to that for a moment, you know, I think the city and the county have been doing things historically to make sure that we fund programs like having counselors in, not only counselors in the schools, but outreach specialists as well. We have a supermajority over at the Texas legislature. They do not listen. They are holding our teachers hostage for a vouchers bill, which is ill-conceived. First one was put together in 1957, right after Brown versus the board. Doesn't surprise me that this legislature has come with the same thing. We need to be thinking about focusing on and preparing for an Edgewood versus Kirby lawsuit. That's even in a hostile judicial environment, we need to lay out what our issues are, because there's no way we'll be able to piecemeal what our kids need, and we need to wrap our resources around how we take a legislature that does not adequately fund public education to court, because that's what they need.
Thank you, Commissioner. I was actually just going to say the same thing, that we do need to really think about collectively finding an appropriate mechanism for taking the state to court. Austin is sending over $800 million to the state to fund schools elsewhere. Even, you know, if Prop A passes, there will be a considerable amount of it that is just going back to the state, and that's not meeting the needs in our, it's unacceptable, and I think that it is high time that we think about a legal strategy that does involve the courts to address the needs, and that may have to happen, you know, through some concerted effort, because it's just simply unacceptable. So I'm on the same wavelength as you. President Singh, and we will also be talking about the budget later, but
yes, I so appreciate the support that our colleagues have shared for our school district, and I just wanted to propose for us to think about maybe forming a little committee with representatives from all three entities to really deep dive into the budget and really explore ways that we might be able to think long term, like over the next 1 to 5 to 10 years, about how we might be able to better support each other financially. And if there's interest.
I think that's a great idea, but let's take that up when we get to the budget item, so that we are yes, on track with the agenda.
Thank you.
No problem. So with that, if there are no more comments, we will move to the childcare discussion, which will likely be brief. We received a written report from the county about the tax rate election, Proposition A, the Travis County CARES initiative. I don't know if either commissioner would like to speak briefly to Proposition A, and then I'll share some updates from the city on other initiatives.
You can start up. Oh, sorry.
And I mean briefly, like we gave you 5 minutes.
I'm Baptist. Brief means something different to me.
That's why.
I'll say that the Commissioner's Court has placed on the November ballot the item which, if it passes, will add 2.5 cents to the tax rate to provide not only 0 through 3 through age 3 child care, but child care through K through 12, because we think that particularly with families who are suffering in poverty, it's important to make sure that we have not only appropriate learning care, but adequate job preparation as well. So we have put the materials together to educate the community about what we're trying to do, and we stand ready to discuss those items and work with this team as much and as soon as possible.
Madam Chair,
that was the Presbyterian version. Yeah.
Thank you.
We appreciate it. Madam Chair, I also just want to chime in. While the county has put the item on the ballot, I think it's really critical to acknowledge the enormous work of Councilmember Alter, Libby Doggett, and also Kathy McHorse from United Way. They and a group of others have done the bulk of the work to prepare this ballot item for the last several years. I think it will be a transformative investment that will profoundly improve the future course of life for thousands of children. So I think this is a huge step we're taking, and I'm enthusiastically in support of it. But I really want to acknowledge the enormous work that you did and brought it to us.
Thank you, Commissioner Shea. This is something that we're really seeing in the community is something that's needed. But I do want to just hearken us back to back in COVID when we were trying to figure out how to deal with a child care system that was imploding. You know, this committee created a child care subcommittee, and we had the conversations, each of us in our own lanes, but working together. And the city put in $11 million of COVID relief money, and the county put a chunk of money, and the work that came out of those investments and those conversations is what is underlying this initiative. And so I think it's a really good example of how the conversations that we have in this space can lead to big changes that really better address our needs. And I think there'll be a subsequent, assuming passage of Prop A, there will be a subsequent set of conversations about how we leverage all of our resources together with the resources from Prop A, whether it's space or opportunities, to host child care centers, et cetera, where we can have those conversations. And so I won't be on this committee come January when that conversation will happen. So I hope that, is something that we can continue to make this be a part of here. So thank you. We wanted to also update you on some things that we've been doing at the city to help support our child care businesses. So as you all know, earlier this year, the City of Austin and Travis County provided 100% property tax abatement to qualifying child care centers following adoption of Proposition 2. We've had at least 23 centers qualify. We have 3 more who are in the process of being qualified and 3 that were not able to meet the bar for that. So those 23 centers at minimum are going to be receiving some significant tax property relief for them. One of the things that we saw right from the beginning was that the enabling state legislation did not allow municipalities or counties to provide this type of property tax relief to home-based providers, which is a significant portion of the child care providers in our community. So to that end, I directed the city manager when we provided direction for Prop 2, we asked the city manager to craft a program that would provide tax relief to home-based providers, as they typically provide that critical support in our community. The city, I want you to know, is a participant in a grant called Homegrown, which is meant to support home-based providers. That design for that grant was completed in fiscal year 24 by Austin Public Health, and Austin Public Health received $25,000 in grant awards. The fiscal year 25 budget that we just approved in August includes $150,000 to the SEND, $75,000 in grant funds, and $75,000 in city funding to implement the grant program. This is a program that's going to allow home-based providers to apply for property tax relief. And if Travis County is interested in implementing something similar, we can put you in touch with our Economic Development Department, with Director Holt Robb and Cynthia Gamez to learn more about those details. Once that grant concludes, we intend to populate that fund with revenue we received through our economic incentive program. We are establishing the city's business expansion program guidelines, and that is going to give high priority consideration for benefits that are community benefits, such as childcare. And so all of the revenue, 10% of that new eligible property tax revenue that's going to come through that program is going to be dedicated towards a childcare assistance reserve, and that is going to be utilized for these home-based childcare property tax reliefs at minimum. There may be more funding for that. We also have established a new place-based enhancement program that we intend to offer property tax abatements to other high-quality childcare providers that don't meet the state's eligibility criteria but do provide high-quality childcare. And there's various qualifications for that. We've also been looking at the fees that our childcare centers are facing. So to that end, the council also approved my proposal to waive street impact fees for childcare centers. We know the margins for these businesses are slim, but their impact is huge. And so that street impact fee is no longer going to be a burden for those. That money will be saved, and those providers will be able to strengthen their programs and expand their businesses. And lastly, we have programs for our public employees, and I want to recognize Councilmember Velasquez's work during the last budget, where he provided direction that the city expand eligibility and increased contributions for our child care assistance program for city employees. That change has led to a 30% increase in program participation. We'd love to see, AISD and Travis County consider something similar if they're able to change their eligibility requirements. We found that made a big difference. So I appreciate the chance to highlight these things. I don't know, Councilmember Velasquez, if you want to add anything, or Councilmember Ryan Alter.
Can the details of that be shared with us, with the committee?
Sure. Stephanie, can you make sure that we have that information?
Yeah, absolutely.
Would you also like the information on the home-based providers as well?
Yes, actually. But we did pass the property tax abatement as well. But yeah, any of the accommodations you've made beyond that?
Yeah, so the challenge is that the Prop 2 tax abatement doesn't apply to home-based mm-hmm. providers because they don't meet the eligibilities. And so we've been trying to figure out a different way to meet their needs because they're operating out of their homes.
That'd be great. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Our next item are some sort of standing written reports or just written reports that we've received. The first one's on resilience hubs, and the second one is on the AISD Prop A voter approved tax rate election. We received written mm-hmm. reports for both of those. I'll start with the resilience hubs, which will be moving to a resilience network model. I think we have folks here we have Mr. Wilson from HESAM. I can't see if Zach's here. I thought I saw him back there. So Zach and Bill are here if people have questions about that backup. This is another example of something that we've been nurturing here in this body, to make sure that communication is happening across entities. But they did provide a written report that talks about how we're going to be transitioning to a resilience network model that will build on the hubs, but allow us to better meet the needs of the community in a more flexible manner, with leadership transitioning to HESAM, which now we have funded staff at HESAM who are doing our mass community care programs, et cetera. So I don't know if anyone has any questions on that.
Madam Chair, yeah, I do. Even though it's brief, I did not read the backup. So Zach or whoever else is here, if you could just give a brief overview of what this will look like transitioning from the hubs to the network, and any kind of practical descriptions would be helpful.
Good morning. Bill Wilson, Interim Director of Austin HESAM. So we learned a lot of lessons from having our pilot program The pilot program was on the hubs, though, which was physical locations. We realized as we're moving forward and we're having more complex disasters and disasters within disasters that we needed something would be able to better meet the community needs, as well as provide a transition back to the community after the city and county pull out of disaster response. So we're working on creating partnerships with organizations that are in the community. We're going to be pulling them into the network, tying in communication pathways so that they can be a part of the disaster and be built into disaster response. And that's going to allow us to have more resources that we can bring to the community. And then more importantly, I think on the back end, whenever the city and county start to drop back out of disaster response, we're already connecting the community members to the people and organizations within the community that can help provide them services as the disaster's ending. Kind of a quick high overview. Zach, did you have anything you'd like to add?
Can you just describe that at a practical level? Part of the vision behind the resilience hubs was when people lose power, particularly if it's during the winter, they can't stay warm in their homes, they can't charge their phones so they can communicate with anyone. So the vision with the resilience hubs was that people would have a place to go where they could get warm, or if it's in the summer, they could cool down, they could charge their phones, they could take care of other things. So how will the network work, and are you abandoning the notion of resilience hubs? That's what I'm trying to understand. If you can just describe the practical way that that will operate.
Yeah, so first, the city of Austin spent $3 million of ARPA funding on improving these six initial pilot resilience hub facilities. So those six facilities now are, the electrical upgrades have been done at those facilities so they can receive backup power, and they have backup power now connected. So when the lights do go out, that's six more facilities in the community that the community knows they can go to, that there will be more resilience in terms of like community spaces that can be accessed. And that goes on. So those facilities are still there, and this network concept basically builds on those facilities.
And are there maps that people can look at now to understand where the resilience hubs are?
So part of this change is allowing additional flexibility. We've learned through disasters that some of the hubs we use have multiple purposes. So sometimes it's going to be stood up as a shelter. Sometimes it's just going to be a resilience hub site. So we'll post locations during a disaster so that that allows us to account for whatever that facility is being purposed for during that disaster response.
I know in some past disasters, there's been instruction, particularly for people who are unhoused, to go to certain locations, which is often difficult because they frequently don't have transportation. And when people have asked me, where can people go, I have to tell them, well, go to this intake area, as opposed to being able to identify where the hubs are. And I realize if you want to remain flexible, you can't say, here are some fixed locations that you can always go to when power goes out or when there's a disaster. But that process of not being able to tell people until there's a disaster has been difficult for some folks, I'll just say.
Okay, and one other thing that, just to note, it's kind of separate than this, but we do have our winter weather shelters, and that one is where we have the embarkation point. During that, we work with different community members to make sure that everyone that is experiencing homelessness has the option to get there. So some of that's going to be through free passes with Cat Metro. Some of it's through the community outreach with organizations that we partner with. We have direct messaging to also let them know that those facilities are going to be stood up. And then often, whenever the weather is going to be significantly bad, we also set up additional van rides and direct pickup for anyone that's unable to make it to the embarkation point.
Yeah, I probably wasn't clear in my question. I hear from community members who are not unhoused, but whose homes don't work very well when the power's out, and they don't know where to go, and all I can tell them is to go to this place where they'll be redistributed. So they're not unhoused, they just need a place that's got functioning power and heating or cooling.
Okay, normally during disasters, we will just publish the multiple locations. Okay. We work in partnership with Cat Metro. That's whenever we do that SR with 311, so that if anyone's having a hard time getting transportation there, they can call 311 and get information. And that's where we have the buses or vans that we coordinate to go pick up individuals to take them to the closest facility available.
So it's when there's a disaster, then the locations are published.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Madam Chair?
Yes, sir.
And I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, colleague, what we have tried to do, and Chuck Brotherton, I think, is in the room as well, we have tried to make sure that there's an asset map and that we, that so we know where we have placed supplies, we know where there have been issues before, because we have after action reports, and they tell us these are the things that we're lacking, these are the things that were asked for, this is how we responded to that. The idea is, I think, how do we have, if not continuous, at least consistent training about, if you live in University Hills, this is where you ought to be looking. If you live in Manor, this is where you ought to be looking. If you live in Pflugerville, or if whatever the community is, at the end of the day, it's important for me to be able to not only send someone to a website, but send someone to a phone number, so that they know who to ask, what to ask, and where to be guided in their own geographic area. I know that you all have done wonderful work, put a lot of materials together, but a lot of times when I ask people, or when people ask me things at the grocery store, at the football game, they have no idea how to find the information. And I just want to make sure that we're able to give warm handoffs to folks who have kids relying on them, neighbors relying on them, are sick and shut in at church. Just want to make sure that they do have access to a process, a system that can take them from where they are to where we need them to be.
So if I can just add that, you know, as we're moving to the resilience network, part of it is following up on after action reports that we had at the city. They're really emphasizing the importance of the community and the community actors and not waiting to the disaster to build those relationships. And so part of what the Resilience Network is gonna do is formalize with memorandums of understanding some of those relationships and their responsibilities, and making sure that the communication is clear. You know, they have their points of contacts at the EOC, and that we're not waiting, you know, to disaster to do the planning, so that folks can get that word out. Every disaster we've learned is different. And, you know, while we will still, you know, if it's hot out, we're going to have, you know, all our libraries are open, and there's different things that people will begin to see some of those patterns. The other thing that we have is part of our HESM work, not necessarily part of the Resilience Network, but it's related, is we have monthly emergency preparedness programming that's going on, rotating across the different districts, where people can come and talk to folks and find out information and get details or get connected if they want to provide resources. And so I think that the, you know, my understanding of this pivot is it's building on the hubs, and that the hubs are still there, but this kind of information sharing, et cetera, will be facilitated by strengthening of these relationships on the ground. Is there anything you guys want to add?
No, I just think that you're exactly right, that the city and our facilities can't be the beginning and the end here, is that the relationships with community organizations, with nonprofits, builds out more strength and more communication. Because like Bill said, we have to be flexible, because it's not, the same disaster doesn't happen over and over. So yeah, I think this is a... expanding on hubs and building to be a more resilient community really starts with relationships and starts with trust, so we can communicate when the bad things do happen.
And I think finally having the staff in HESM to play these roles, which were very much part of our recommendations that we got back, will be really important. Those relationships also will be, you know, further building with AISD, you know, and understanding stuff about emergency capacity and other kinds of things that will also take place. Okay, thank you.
Madam Chair, I have a question.
Sure.
So I live in Dove Springs, and so the last time we had a disaster, there was a change on intake that everyone had to come to South First and the Texas One Center, and that Cap Metro was providing transportation. But when the weather is not drivable, it was just a huge issue to try to come to one place to do a intake. Is that going to change in your strategy about people by partnering with organizations that they'll be able to do intake wherever they are?
Yes, ma'am. So we have different types of responses to events. The only time that we use the registration at One Texas Center is whenever we do our winter weather sheltering for those experiencing homelessness, and that's targeted at life safety and keeping people or allowing people the option to become indoors whenever our temperatures are going to drop below 35 degrees. Whenever we have a disaster that's impacting the community and we're standing up shelters city and county wide, for those will be the ones that we publish and either allow people to get there or use our SR with 311 to provide assistance to get people to those locations.
Okay, because I know you keep saying homeless, and like Commissioner Shea says, some people are not homeless. They just lost their power. And when they left in Dove Springs, when they went to the rec center, they were not allowed to go in because they were not considered homeless. And so they were sent away, and those families with children. So I hope it's very clear that the shelters is for everyone and not just for homeless.
Yes, ma'am. We do try to set up additional facilities for families and other things just to make sure that we don't have any issues with the populations that are in the shelters. If we've worked with staff to make sure that I heard of that incident happening and that's been addressed to make sure that no one gets turned away at any point and everyone is allowed access to all shelters.
Thank you.
Thank you. So next up we have we received a presentation backup from AISD for the voter-approved tax rate election. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
And feel free if you haven't already to grab a lunch before you go. So I don't know that we're doing the prep. I don't know that the presentation is being presented as much as it was the backup that was provided. But I don't know if President Trustee Preston Singh, if you'd like to make any comments on the voter-approved tax rate election. You don't need to. We have the backup, but we have about 5 minutes here if you want to.
Yeah, sure. I think most folks know that AISD will have Proposition A on the ballot this November, not to be confused with the Travis County Proposition A, which is on child care, but really they both serve our families. So the main thing, the main takeaways for y'all are this will bring $41 million in new dollars into AISD per year. The other thing to know is that the state of Texas has not increased the basic allotment, which is the per pupil amount of funding, in 5 years. And just think about what we've endured during those 5 years. Our kids are still suffering from COVID effects. Inflation, we've got double-digit inflation, and we have a large school district with 73,000 students that need supports. And this money would go towards teacher compensation. It would help increase the wages for all of our hourly workers. It would also go towards academic supports and mental health supports and instructional coaches, all which will have a direct impact on student outcomes. And it will also help stabilize us financially because it is very important to our board and to our administration that we keep our AAA bond ratings and the highest fiscal responsibility ratings that the state of Texas can give a district. We have that, and it is very important for us to keep that. But to do that, we have to keep 20% of our operating budget and reserves. And we have Katrina Montgomery, who's our acting CFO, and Dr. Jacob Reach here as well to correct me if I'm wrong. But the board did vote to support this. And I'll just open it up to any questions that folks might have since we have our experts here as well.
And I will just point out the next item is to talk about the AISD budget. And so it may, we also could.
Oh, yeah, let's just combine it with that.
We might take that presentation and then do questions because they might answer that unless you want to jump in.
I just think that a discussion that provides some of the data from the backup is really important. I'm under no illusions that there's a huge audience watching this, but I think every opportunity we have to educate the public about why this election is so crucial, what the problems are, particularly at the state level, that have gotten us here, in addition to the failure to increase funding for 5 years. Texas is $4,000 behind the national average in per student funding for instance. So I think just some of those data points are useful. So I don't know if it makes sense to combine that with a budget discussion, but I just think people need to have a deeper understanding of why this is so important.
Agreed. And I will mention that most of the school districts in Central Texas have passed deficit budgets. So just let that sink in. That is not the way public education should be funded when you've got almost 75% of us doing that. And a recent Rice University study found that over 70% of school districts were severely underfunded. So these are things for us all to consider, particularly as the legislative session is coming up. And I want to ask Katrine, Ms. Montgomery, are you going to be going over some of this in the budget presentation? Okay, so we'll just kind of save some more of that for that. But
I do think it's important for people to understand the reason that we've gotten into this situation of, severely underfunded public schools in Texas is because of political and policy decisions by the leadership at the state level. They have $36 billion in surplus funds. There's no excuse for them to be chronically and in such a damaging fashion underfunding public education, except that they have a philosophy supports private religious education instead of public education. And people need to understand that, because it's not accidental that the schools are starving and the students don't have enough funding and that the teachers are underpaid and a whole host of problems across the board. It's because of policy decisions and political actions at the state level.
I don't know that I would say religious. I would say conservative nationalist religion, which is different than...
That is true. It's white nationalist religion. There have been a number of reports about the chief funders who are driving the governor's actions.
So why don't we go into the budget presentation and then we can continue the conversation as appropriate. I think some of this we talked about a little bit earlier when the city manager was here, I think before you got here, Commissioner Shea.
Good afternoon. My name is Jacob Reach. I'm the Chief Officer for Governmental Relations and Board Services for Austin ISD.
Hello, everyone. I am Katrina Montgomery, the Interim CFO at Austin ISD.
And so today we want to share a little bit about the budget work we've been doing in our long-term budget planning. Before we get started with our slides, I do very much want to take the opportunity to thank our committee member who came out today and also left some comments with the committee. But we appreciate everyone who's part of the committee that we're currently working on. Mm-hmm. So ready? I'm doing this. Yeah.
Okay. So as I'm sure you all are aware, we have a ad hoc budget committee that has been helping us work through our budget concerns. And we also have our trustees who are helping us also talk about ways that we can get into this deficit and decrease it. But let's talk about the committee's charge. The committee is charged to create lists of areas for further exploration. So what other ways can we try to find ways to reduce our expenditures? Explore budget ideas for $500,000 plus, test and refine equity-based rubric, and create lists of potential cuts to be evaluated using our equity-based rubric. And the plan is going to be over 3 years. So the deficit that we currently have, which is $92 million, thank you, we're going to clear this deficit up over 3 years. So let's talk about this slide. We call it the Cascade Implementation Plan. And so if you look in your far left-hand side, it says fiscal year. So we've broken this out by fiscal years, and then you have our deficit. So let's look at the first row. Fiscal year 24-25, our deficit is $48 million. That is what we're saying we're going to identify as far as cuts and make reduction strategies. So in 24-25, we're going to reduce our deficit by $26 million. We've been working with our chiefs and making sure we can attain this goal by reducing this $26 million in 24-25. 25. And then in 25-26, we have an additional identified reductions of $22 million. So in total for 24-25, a quick way to look at this is there's going to be $48 million worth of our deficit. We're going to identify $48 million. $26 million have to take in effect this fiscal year, 24-25, and the additional $22 million will take or have an impact in fiscal year 25-26. So then if you go to the next row, 25-26, it says we're going to do an additional amount of $25 million. So the second column, the deficit, that's where our current year deficit is, $92 million. So we're looking at it saying over 3 years, how are we going to decrease this deficit of $92 million? So 24-25, we're going to reduce $26 million in total. 25-26, we're going to reduce $47 million. And 26-27, we're going to reduce $19 million. So in each of these years, we're going to be reducing our deficit or increasing our revenue strategies, but the budgets that we pass must be balanced. So we can't continue to grow this deficit. We have to make sure we're cutting these numbers, these amounts, $26 million in 24-25, $47 million in 25-26, and $19 million in 26-27. Yes, ma'am.
Do these numbers assume that the tax rate election passes?
They do.
And that's
yes.
where the revenue will come from.
Yes.
So if the tax rate election doesn't pass, we're looking at probably extreme budget cuts.
Yes. If the tax rate doesn't pass, so Trustee Singh, President Singh said the net amount is $41 million. So the quick math that we could do is you take the 92 plus the 41 million.
So I want to go off slide a little bit and go back to Commissioner Shea's earlier question on what's some of the good information that was in that Prop A presentation. And I want to share a little bit about how did we get here. So we've already shared and it was already discussed that we are about 4,000 behind on the national average on per pupil spending when you compare states. The last legislative session, the state actually set aside, as you know, $5 billion for public education. That money never got spent. It went back into the governor's budget at the end of the fiscal year and was not spent on public education as it was dedicated for. So people commonly ask, well, how did Austin ISD get here? How did you get to a $92 million deficit, you know, in about 1 year? And so I want to share a little bit about that and kind of respond to that question. First, which was already brought up, is inflation. And not only has our cost of business, just like all of our other governmental entities, gone up, our insurance, our cost of supplies and materials, but our cost of labor has gone up. The state actually identified last year that teacher pay was a serious problem for teacher retention in Texas. And they said that that would be a priority, but there was no additional funding at the end of the day for teacher pay. Austin ISD did increase teacher pay because we recognize that we compete for labor just like many other governmental entities. And we wanted to keep those great teachers in Austin ISD. So we provided one of the larger raises that we've ever provided as a district. And it was necessary to ensure that we were valuing the great contribution of our teachers and our staff. That did not see any additional funding from the state, even though they said pay for teachers was a priority. So inflation is certainly one. Another one, which I'm going to talk about in a later presentation, is our cost for special education. We're spending about $25 million more on special education over the last 2 years as we ensure that we are meeting every student's need in special education. So this is just a summary number. Don't write it down as the actual number, but basically Austin ISD spends about $160 million on special education. Through the state and federal government and dedicated funding for special education, we get about $50 million. So we have about $110 million gap that we as a district are going above and beyond because we know that's what our students and our staff need to properly provide a special education program in a school district. So when we consider those different items, you can see how that can add up leading towards $92 million. As addition, as you all know, because you probably also felt, our growth is not as high for this fiscal year in property values as it was for previous years. For Austin ISD, as you probably also know, we rely on our taxes a little bit different than the city and the county. The city and the county set their budget, then set their rate, and I know I'm simplifying it, but set their rate to make sure that they're bringing in the money for their budget. Austin ISD looks at what the tax rate will allow us to bring in, and then we have to set our budget off of that. So we don't have the same ability to change our tax rate that some of our other municipal governments have. And so when property growth is not as strong, that's further where we can see these numbers change. And then finally, while we have remained steady in our student population over the last 2 years, which we're proud of, we do recognize that there was a lot of student loss during those COVID years. And many people think, well, if you lost 500 students, you just need to reduce by 20 teachers, and there, now it's even. You know, same amount of money across the board. But school districts don't lose students evenly, nor do we lose them all in one place. We lose, you know, one at third grade at this elementary, one at eighth grade at this middle school, and so on and so forth across the entire district. And a teacher's salary is a teacher's salary. Whether I have 28 kids in that class or I have 8 kids in that class, that teacher's salary is the same. Furthermore, our state, along with only 2 other states in the entire nation, still funds based off of attendance. So they're not funding based off of the total number of kids. They're giving us money based off of the total number of kids and how many days they're in attendance. Well, again, I'm paying a teacher their salary, as we should, based off of their role. Not that today you only had 8 kids in the classroom and normally you have 14, mm-hmm. but that's how the state's funding us. They're saying today you only had 8 kids, so I'm only giving you money for 8 kids, even though the major cost driver, our staff, doesn't change at all during that time. So I just wanted to share all that to kind of give an idea on how we got to where we're at today. So now I want to share a little bit more about our committee and the work that we're doing. What we've shared is a calendar of the committee's work and how we're dividing it up. So at our committee meetings, and they're every Tuesday, I'll mention, we hold both Zoom and in person at our Performing Arts Center. They're open to the public. Individuals are welcome to attend. But at each of these meetings, we break down a portion of our district's budget by department, and then we go through in depth and detail that department and understanding where there could be room for exploration for potential cost drivers or cost savings. So at our last meeting a week ago, we went through a lot of our operations team, facility management, custodial transportation. Transportation, I'll go ahead and throw this one out there as well, is another one to where the state provides us $6 million for transportation. It cost us $40 million to operate transportation in Austin ISD. So a difference of about $34 million that we need to cover ourselves. At our next meeting tomorrow night, we're going to cover our IT department along with legal and police. And then we'll continue to go through discussing each of these departments. Our hope is working with our committee to not only generate questions and ideas that we can then look more in depth for potential cost savings, but also run some of these ideas with our committee through what Ms. Montgomery just mentioned, our equity rubric. So we can ensure that when we are considering potential cuts, that we are not disproportionately affecting our most marginalized communities. Mm-hmm. We know that in the past, sometimes cuts were just done across the board. And then what we learn later is that those effects may be felt differently across different campuses. So we want to consider that up front now so that we don't learn a year from now that that effect did not really, or I'm sorry, that that cut did not really affect one campus over here, but it had a great effect on a campus elsewhere. We want to have a better understanding of that overall at the start before we bring that forward to our board for discussion. So these conversations will continue through the end of October. And at that last meeting, we want to make sure that we're looking through all of our final data and also then talking about our teaching and learning team, which is really about the classroom. We want to make sure that we go through all of that operational items first before we start talking about cuts that could affect the classroom. Because that's, you know, just to put it plainly, that's where the magic happens. That's where we make a difference with kids. So that needs to be the last place that we look, the last place that we make cuts before we consider everything else. Overall, this is our timeline for the year. And a lot of the work that we're looking at right now, you may say, oh, you know, you're doing a lot of work in September and October. That's pretty quick. And we will agree with you. We'll be the first to say that, yeah, that is quick. But as just like the city and like the county, you know, our budget year starts pretty much as soon as the year starts. And we start getting budget out to our campus in January. So if you're looking at this calendar, you'll see that we want to get a lot of this work done before November or in November, so that in December, we're presenting plans to our Board of Trustees, getting their feedback, taking any appropriate votes that the board may need to consider, and then also ensuring that we're getting notification out to our campuses before they get their budget, so that we're not coming back later and saying, oh, you thought your budget was this, but now it's actually going to need to be this. So this will allow us to do it up front, so campuses know what they're dealing with in January, and then will help us when we start looking at our preliminary overall district budget, which we'll do in April. And then just as a reminder, as a school district, we actually approve our budget in June. We are July to June for our fiscal year. So we'll make those final decisions and final approval by our Board of Trustees in June. And so that's an overview of our long-term budget work. I know we put a lot of information in just a few slides, but both of us are ready to discuss more about our budget or this budget work or answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. I think this presentation just further underscores the need for us to have a collective effort, particularly at the legislature and in the courts, to further address recapture and really just the underfunding of the basic allotment, which has a huge impact on Austin, but it impacts every student in state. But because of the cost of living in Austin, it's particularly dire here. And, you know, this has been a longstanding concern of mine, but I'll just say that I think we've gotten to a point where there's no way other than to really raise as much hell as we can. And fortunately, we live in Austin and can go to the legislature, and I think we're going to have to just really make sure that people know what's going on with this process as we move forward. Are there questions or comments on the budget from anyone else?
Madam Chair.
Commissioner Shea and then Commissioner Ryan.
Can we plan for a next joint subcommittee to have an executive session and bring in legal guidance mm-hmm. on this issue? I'm assuming that'll take place before the legislative session, but I agree. I think this just seems so profoundly wrong and certainly legally questionable, but I'd like for us to get legal guidance and to have us schedule an executive session in order to have that discussion.
So we are hoping to have, I think that's a great idea, we are hoping to have a meeting either on December 2nd or 6th, which would be, if we could manage it, would be before the legislative session.
Yeah.
And I think it would be interesting for all of us to hear collectively from the different
yes.
lawyers, the legal groups, and have them have to have a conversation before then about what could this look like and what would need to happen. And it may be that we have to approach this. You know, I'm not a lawyer, so there could be many different ways to approach it. But I think it would be interesting to hear from all three bodies, legal departments,
yeah,
as to what might be feasible.
Follow-up question, but if there's other
Madam Chair,
mm-hmm.
I think we should also consider bringing in civil rights organizations as well. A lot of our lawyers don't deal with civil rights issues and don't litigate them regularly. And I think it's important to use the body of information that we already have access to, people who have been doing this for 10, 20, 30 years, to make sure that we are actually understanding what's going on around us, what decisions have been handed down over the last 2 to 3 years, and where we have an opportunity to make progress. Because it is unusual that the walls come tumbling down at one time. It is an incremental process, and it needs to be planned well.
So I appreciate that, Commissioner Trevelyan. I believe ASD, are you hosting next? Is that?
Yes, we are.
Yeah, perhaps you can connect with your staff liaison, who can connect with them and make sure that they have the names. I'm not sure about any rules within executive session if you're bringing in legal advice,
outside
counsel that is not hired, how that works. But I'm sure that there's a way to do that. to hear from them and or their for a portion of the session, and that may even be what we, you know, decide that we focus the session on. If they're not, there may be also some follow up for the child care, you know, that we want to do at the next meeting. But I think that's a great idea. And if you know those lawyers who, in Austin, who you think would be particularly helpful, I think it would jumpstart the process to have them in communication with the rest of the legal team.
I do, and it's going to be a hostile process. At the end of the day, we've been sued at least three times by doing things like making sure that people were taken off the voting rolls, had an opportunity to be put back on. So my expectation is that there will be litigation all along the way, but this is important enough to draw a line in the sand and fight.
Yes, I agree. Councilmember Ryan Alter.
Thank you very much. I think most importantly for this group, and I know when I've talked to the superintendent, we can't rely on the legislature. They may do the right thing, probably not. So we need to figure out as local governments how we can come together and have a local solution to this problem. It's not just an AISD issue. What happens at the district directly affects the city and vice versa. We need to make it affordable and desirable for families to live here in Austin so that your enrollment numbers do go up. And that helps with the funding that you receive and fill the schools and ultimately reinforces itself and leads to economic opportunity and prosperity here at the city. And I think it's really the neat part about a group like this. You have Commissioner Trevelyan, who also sits on Cap Metro, and you talked about the transit issue, right? Well, Cap Metro is a local organization that can be at the table and help us regionally look at how we can together figure out what roles everybody is playing and where we might all step in to help. You know, you are now being asked to be a 100-plus person police department. Right? That is traditionally a city role. I mentioned public health earlier. There are a number of other things that school districts are now being asked to do, tasked to do, that fall traditionally to other governmental entities. So where can we leverage our ability to generate revenue that isn't subject to recapture or other types of reallocation? And so I would love for us to have those conversations as a group to figure out how we might all come to the table, Central Health being another, and working on that. I am curious, as we look towards the legislative session, just so, you know, you raised the question, I've heard it too, the how did we get here? Oh my gosh, you know, where did this budget deficit come from overnight? I remember last session, the number was around $1,000. If you pegged the basic allotment to inflation from 2019, it would have been raised about $1,000. Have you run the numbers on, let's just use that $1,000, how much more the district would have generated for the budget? Do you have a rough estimate?
If it was pegged to inflation?
Well, if the state raised the basic allotment by $1,000, how much the district, AISD, would stand to benefit? I mean, I know 73,000 students, you'd think it'd be over 73 million, but you've got your multipliers, so I would think probably somewhere in the 80 to 90 million dollar range.
We can do the math in a second, but we gotta.
Yeah, sure. And the reason I'm asking is because, you know, you look at a 90-something million dollar deficit, and that's significant, but if 85 million of that is simply because it hasn't kept up with inflation, I think people can understand that. And so when we talk about why do we need Prop A, or why does the legislature need to step up and just do the basic of keeping things flat, not even giving us, you know, a cost-based, you talk about special education, a cost-based allocation to do what we've been told we have to do by state and federal law, then it's a good thing you're doing it. But I think that would help in our conversations that we're having.
It would be somewhere around $80 million, but we would want to
Sure.
Actually do the math to get a more exact figure.
Sure. And the same question as it relates to enrollment-based funding, right? Enrollment versus your actual attendance. I know that's a conversation that's being had at the legislature, and so as those efforts move forward, you know, how much money does the district stand to gain there, and how much of the cuts would that offset? And so that can help with our efforts, both in terms of advocacy and talking just to neighbors as well.
Yeah. So roughly, if the state did not change the basic allotment when changing systems, which of course we would suggest that they not do, which is what other states have not done, right. It would bring in about $20 million.
Okay. And that's obviously very significant to the cuts you're looking at. And I also want to just bring to the district's attention, the city is hopefully here soon poised to pass what is called the Solar Standard Offer. It is a payment from the city, the Austin Energy, to commercial or large scale facility operators that if you put solar on top of your building, we will pay you for basically that generation at a standard rate. And so instead of just talking about how we are going to cut various programs, the city, the county, the school district are large facility owners. You have great roof space. How might we partner with y'all to have y'all participate in this program and us bring some of that money to the table in order for you to basically lease that space on your roof and monetize those now empty roofs? You know, I think that would be an opportunity worth exploring, and obviously have environmental benefits as well as monetary benefits. So I just want to bring that to your attention as well as we have the funding discussion. So that's, I could talk about this all day, but I really appreciate the work you're doing, and I know how hard the situation is when it's out of your hands in a lot of ways, and so appreciate the efforts. I know it's hard.
Thank you, and I know Councilmember Ryan Alter, you had tried to pursue a couple of different ideas, and we were not able to make them pan out in time for various deadlines, and I hope you'll continue to resurrect those. It is painful to have to send even additional money from Travis County to the state. And, you know, just again, what you said, where, you know, if we increase the per student allotment, if we change how we count, you know, attendance versus enrollment, that those things do make a difference. They make a difference not just for Austin, they make a difference for all of Central Texas, they make a difference for students all across the state. This is not just something that's hurting Austin. We've been paying recapture for a long time, which hurts us with respect to our taxes, but these adjustments need to happen for every child across the state. Any other last comments, Commissioner Shea?
Yeah, I had a couple of questions to try and understand how to explain the deficit along the lines of what Councilmember Alter has been talking about. Did I understand that, I don't know where this $1,000 per student number came from. Was that something that the legislature was considering but didn't fund?
No, the legislature was considering, was it $60? It was $60 or $80. I don't remember the exact number.
Last session, some of the outside groups put forward that if you kept the basic allotment up with inflation, you would need to raise it about $1,000.
Okay, that's what I was trying to understand. So really, if you just kept up with inflation, like cost of living increases or something like that, it would mean that AISD would have about $80 million more? Was that your rough calculation?
Yeah, it would be a little bit higher, but I'm not sure on the exact amount.
So, I mean, that goes a long way, because I get these questions as well. How did the school district develop such a massive deficit? So if the legislature had just funded student allotments to keep up with inflation, you would have more than $80 million extra per year. So take that, you know, subtract that from the $95 million deficit. And then do many school districts fund based on attendance versus enrollment? We're a real outlier in that regard, right?
Yeah.
That's what
so
I want to understand.
There's three states that fund based off of attendance instead of enrollment.
And let me guess. No, you tell me
yeah,
what
so
states.
Actually California is one of them.
Oh, shocking.
And they're the, yeah, so the, you know, two of the three largest school districts or states fund based off of attendance.
That was, but it's from Prop 13.
Yeah, I want to say the other one's Nebraska. It may be Missouri.
So we are an outlier nationally in
completely
funding
an outlier
based on attendance versus enrollment.
And California is currently under a study to change to doing it by enrollment.
And if we funded based on enrollment, that would generate an additional, was it roughly $20 million?
Yeah, I would need to check. So it would be that it would be like you have 100% attendance. So it'd be an 8% increase in your WADA.
I'm just trying to get some really kind of basic numbers that a fifth grader would understand, because that's the level I'm working at with the AISD budget. But to explain to people how the school district got such a big deficit. So inflation and funding on enrollment instead of attendance. So the other question I had, twofold, the special education costs.
Yeah.
If the district spends somewhere around $160 million a year, and that includes the additional $25 million that we've spent to, enhance the special education programs, but we only get $50 million from state and federal funds, are those funding sources that were presumed initially to fully fund special education? Was that the intention, or was
that
it always the intention?
Yes.
So the intention was that the state and federal money would fully fund special education, but that has not kept up.
That is the intention, yes.
Okay. And then on transportation.
Wait, can I say one more thing about the SPED funding?
Yeah.
Is IDEA is a federal law to fund special education. And at the federal level, it's not being completely funded, right? And it's only being funded about 14% of what it should be. So this is very much a federal issue as well as a state issue.
Well, maybe we know somebody who can do something
level. I know. There's not a whole lot of interest in Congress, from what I hear, to actually enforce this law.
Wow. So the feds should be funding it certainly much more. Mm-hmm. And that would help with it, the deficit.
Correct.
As well. And then on transportation, is it only the state that provides additional funding there and clearly not enough? Or do the feds also help with transportation, or is that just state and local?
It's only, there's always grants, but really it's only the state.
And it's costing us $40 million and the state is funding $6 million. Was the intent there that the state would fund more of that?
Yeah, so they're using a per mile rate that's, I don't even know how old at this point. It's over 30 years old. So they're saying they fund us based off of a per student mile. So they calculate the number of kids on the bus and divide it by how many miles that bus drives. And that's how you generate funding on approved routes only. But even for our approved routes, we're only getting about a quarter of what that actually cost us, because gas isn't 78 cents a gallon anymore, and bus drivers aren't paid $6 an hour anymore.
So their funding formula has not increased for 30 years on the price of gas per mile?
It's a very old funding formula for transportation. Yeah.
But it was what the price of gas was, say, 30 years ago per mile? Well, that is crazy. Those kinds of really simple explanations, I think, would be helpful, because they lay out these really, really large additional costs that are being forced on the local school districts and that are really harming AISD. Thank you. Appreciate that.
I'd like to add one more thing. I don't think you talked about House Bill 1605. Well, so there's two things. One is, in the last legislative session, there was a law passed that required us to put armed officers at every campus, and that was underfunded. So we're paying about $8 million, right, Ms. Montgomery, $8 million or more to make up the difference.
In addition, that's right.
That's right. So we are incurring, so this is an unfunded mandate or underfunded mandate by the state. And then secondly, there's a grander scheme at work here. House Bill 1605 is something that was passed. Part of that bill basically says that the state can create a curriculum that is very much I'll speak for myself, not on behalf of the board here, but it is a very conservative nationalism sort of Bible-infused curriculum that many of you might have been hearing about. The State Board of Education right now is considering this curriculum. But it would actually And so the TEA would pay school districts $60 per student to adopt this curriculum. So on one hand, we are being severely underfunded. On the other hand, they're saying, hey, but we'll pay you to adopt a curriculum that we develop.
So they're bribing the school districts to use Bible-based education at the public schools?
Nationalist Bible.
Yeah, not that there's anything wrong with the Bible, but it shouldn't be taught in public schools. Wow. Wow.
And don't forget, for Austin, the formulas for recapture are 30 plus years old and and kind of ridiculous, in that we're sending $800 million out of our city when we have a deficit and we have children in our needs. And, you know, even if we got the $1,000 for inflation, even if we got the enrollment bumps, you know, there's still plenty of things that we could be doing to better serve our kids. And Texas is in the bottom for per pupil spending as it is. We are 10% of the public school kids in the country in Texas, and we spend the least, and our outcomes, you know, sometimes do reflect that.
So we are at the very bottom, or almost at the bottom?
We are in the 40s something, but I don't know where we are.
Yeah, somewhere right in the bottom now. 10.
We're in the bottom 10.
It's like 43, I think.
Yeah. I do want to
spend less than, what was it, Alabama? Like,
yeah, who was that? I don't remember. But I do want to raise up something that this council member, Alterman, had mentioned, which was, you know, how do we become more self-reliant on our funding? And I'm really eager to explore ways for that to happen. And I'm also eager to explore ways that we can, as three governing entities, can work really together to ensure that we are being extremely strategic and making the most of every dollar. And so I think it would be really helpful to convene a smaller working group with us, you know, at least one representative from each governing entity, along with some of our financial folks from the different entities, to really sit down, go through the numbers, and think through, okay, where could we align resources here or here or here? Because even if AISD Prop A passes, we're still talking about a tremendous amount of budget reduction. And these are things that are going to be... the things that are on the chopping block, for lack of a better term, are things that directly impact not only families in the way we traditionally think about families and services, but also things like career and technical programs. This is very much a workforce issue. You know, the city of Austin is trying to, I think, fill 10,000 new advanced manufacturing jobs over the next few years. Well, those are going to be AISD grads. And if you don't have students who know what advanced manufacturing is and aren't coming out of school or ready to work or ready to pursue further education in that field, that impacts all of us as a city. And we want to make sure that we continue, you know, leaning on workforce solutions, looking at like the other governing or the other entities around here, and really looking at this through a workforce lens as well as like a public health lens and everything else that's important to us. But we are producing the workers of tomorrow for our region. And so we've all got to put our minds together to think about how to best serve them. So I really appreciate your lifting up all those thoughts.
So far we have said that we want to have executive session on our next meeting, December 2nd or 6th. If you haven't responded to your staff liaison about your availability, please do that. And then so we can get that scheduled. It would be December 2nd or December 6th in the same kind of time period. It would be at AISD. I'm going to ask President Singh if folks are interested in serving on that committee to talk with you, since I think you're the only board member continuing. So commissioners, if there's one of you that's interested in participating in that, let President Singh know, and Ryan or Jose, if you want to let her know as well. You can have more than one if more than one is interested. I think that would be a great next step for this committee. We're going to move now to the TEA approved. Thank you. We're going to now move to the TEA approved order on special education. And I'll just say that, you know, we do have a hard stop today. Ideally, a little before 1:30, Commissioner Trevelyan and I both have to get to Campo on the other side of town. So
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I do have to step out, so I just wanted to make everybody aware of that.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Reach?
Well, thank you so much. Thanks for having me back. Thank you so much. So I think it was about a year ago, it may have been about 10 months ago, that I last provided you an update on the TEA agreed order. And so happy to be back and letting you know what's happened over the last year. So as a reminder, our TEA agreed order was entered in with the Texas Education Agency last August in order to satisfy a series of corrective actions that were opened against Austin ISD due to, admittedly, us failing to provide timely evaluations of students for special education and ensuring that those evaluations were then put in place in what we call an IEP, an Individualized Education Plan, and that those were timely put in place for students. So this agreed order required multiple things, and there was actually the overall agreement and then four priorities that we needed to satisfy. So the first part of the agreement was, of course, satisfying the open corrective action, and that our Board of Trustees would also be required to go through certain training, which I'll talk about in a moment. And then each of those priorities listed one of the major concerns that TEA had at that time based off of our special education program. So since we've met from a year ago, we have now completed 71 out of 99 of the required tasks in that agreed order. In addition, we have completed everything under priority one, priority, and priority four. While priority three is complete, as in we've done our initial submissions, those are required monthly, so they don't really complete until we are completely done with the order overall, but we have done our initial submission. So I'm going to go into a little bit of detail on each one. The first one is the overall agreed order and what we normally refer to as the Lone Star Governance portion. So it required that our Board of Trustees implement a Lone Star Governance process and then also meet a certain score on the Lone Star Governance evaluation. So the board did their last self-evaluation in August, and at that meeting, they scored a 66, which was a meets focus, which was the requirement under the approved order. So now the board is required to maintain that meets focus for at least three more quarters. So all in all, it'll be a complete year, but they've completed one, now they have three more to go. And they will do another quarterly evaluation at the end of this month. Priority one was...
Can I say something, Dr. Reach? And you're not, you didn't brag on us, but we actually met our deadline a full year before TEA required us to. Yes, thank you. And our Lone Star Governance coach actually really said very effusively wonderful things about this, and she has never worked with a board that has been able to move so quickly through the Lone Star Governance requirements, and that's a testament to our entire board and the administrative team for all the hard work they've done. Congratulations. Thank you.
So under priority one, this was satisfying the open corrective action plans. At the time that TEA placed us under the order, we had 15 open corrective actions with the Texas Education Agency. Since that time, we have completed all of those corrective actions. In addition, we have completed all of the outstanding evaluations that were done prior to the start of the order. And while not part of the order, I do want to also report that we have managed to not add to our outstanding evaluations, so those that are out of timeline, since we really since about October of last year. So in other words, we're completing all of our evaluations on time now. We've also completed a determination of all the students who were outstanding to determine if they needed compensatory services, which is just additional services that they're due because they did not get services during a time period they should have because they were late. So we have completed all those determinations. And while not part of priority one, we would also want to mention, and we shared this last month at our board meeting, that we were under a lawsuit that came from an outside organization that actually brought some of this to TEA's attention. And we've also completed everything in that lawsuit that was associated with outstanding evaluations. So our priority two is identifying and implementing effective practices. This is really about the professional development for our staff and ensuring that we have a strong program in Austin ISD. So we've actually completed a state of our special education. We provided that to our board back in June. We've also developed a new SPED evaluation manual and a multi-tiered system of supports manual, which I'll refer to as MTSS. And MTSS, again, is just the series of services that you provide to a student, understanding that at some point they may need additional services, so then they rise up a tier, and that's a three-tier system. We've trained all campus staff and all central office staff on some portions of this, and all campus staff and all campus leadership on all of the MTSS programs. So that's over 6,000 teachers that we got trained during the summer, which I will tell you, a year ago, we sat there and discussed, how are we actually going to get that done? We were able to build in some professional development days for our teachers at the start of the school year. So paying them to come in a little bit early so we can complete that. But that was difficult, but we did move forward on it. And then this year, we've actually implemented that new MTSS system. So through the year, we're going to continue to not only implement it, but also train our staff on the protocols and walkthroughs for MTSS. And then we'll also provide quarterly updates to our Board of Trustees, and we're going to do our first one at our board meeting this month. So priority three was our data systems. One concern that TEA raised was that they felt that when they were asking us for data, they would get different data at different points. And they just felt it was not reliable data. And, you know, we want to be honest, that was correct. We did not have reliable systems that provided the data that we needed to make actionable choices when it came to what was best for our students. So we've implemented a lot of new data systems and trained our staff on that. And we have started submitting monthly reports to TEA that shows summary of all of our all of our special education data. Yes, sir.
So excuse me, but is it not true that since integration, the special education has primarily been used as a disciplinary tool? It has not had all of the diagnostic tests or information that are necessary to identify different forms of dyslexia or other issues and address them. I mean, I understand what you're saying, that we're not gathering all of the information that we should gather. We never have. It was never intended for that purpose until this legislature decided that this was a way to ding some of our school districts. I understand that we are not doing some of the things that have been asked for, but we've never done the things that they're asking for. And that's disingenuous without providing the resources that are necessary, not only to diagnose, but then to address the diagnosis.
Yeah.
I guess you probably shouldn't answer that on camera.
One thing that I will answer, that again, we want to be transparent, we want to be upfront, and we want to make sure that we're addressing where we see areas for concern, is when we see disproportionality in students that are referred for special education. That's something that we need to address, and we believe strongly that if we have strong academic systems, then we're not going to see those referrals that should not be happening. And so one thing that we are tracking is not just the disproportionality of who is referred, but those students who actually, what we call D&Q, they did not qualify. So they were referred, but they did not need special education services. And trying to understand that really that number should be zero. But how, if we have strong academic systems, that should address students being referred in the first place. I know that only answers a very small part of your question, or addresses a small part, but it is something that we look at carefully with what we're monitoring right now.
So when you say disproportionality, should I understand that to mean that the number of minority students assigned to special education far outrates the numbers in which they are part of the student body?
That's correct. So, we commonly say that like an African-American male is twice as likely to be referred than any other student, which should not mathematically make sense.
Are you seeing those kinds of numbers decline, or do you expect that you would, since you've now trained 6,000 staff, I guess, to have a better understanding of how to either refer or diagnose or
That's right. We do expect that the training is going to lead to to assigning support as needed and not saying that this is, you know, a referral for special education. It may just be a referral to help reread this passage with that student, or that's not even a referral, just a know-how in the classroom. And so we do expect that that training should make a difference in what we see in disproportionality in students who do not qualify once they complete their evaluations. It should decrease those. So our last priority was parent outreach. So this was ensuring that we have established and developed a parent and family outreach campaign in Austin ISD. A couple things that we did for that. One, it created new materials around what it is an evaluation, what does a parent need to know if they get an evaluation for their student or if they get special education services for their student, making that more accessible for our family members. We created a new website. All of these materials are available in multiple languages. While we have over 90 languages in Austin ISD, we were not able to touch all of them. We've moved beyond, you know, typically, so we always have materials in English, and commonly we have them in Spanish. But we made a purpose that on this, we wanted to include English, Spanish, Vietnamese, Korean, Chinese, French, and there's another language, I believe it's Arabic. And so we were able to provide all of these materials in multiple languages to make them more accessible to more of our families. We've also created a brand new committee, the Special Education Family Advisory Committee. Their next meeting will be October 28th, and their role is to not only give us feedback on everything that I've gone through today, but on the new systems that we're actually implementing. So our special education handbook, our special education guidance. They're providing us feedback on that from a parent and family perspective. We also have staff on there, although the purpose from TEA was to bring family members. They were okay with us expanding it, so we've also included staff. But getting their perspective on these choices and changes before we actually make them. So again, next meeting, October 28th, open to the public. It'll be at our central office. And that is an overview of our special education agreed order with TEA.
Thank you. Your last comment just brought up another area that I want to flag for Councilmember Ryan Alter, where we may be able to help. We have some new systems for language translation, et cetera, and there may be some economies of scale where if we are coordinating amongst entities that the price goes down, or where we can assist with that. I don't know all the details on them, but they're pretty cool. So, thank you. Sure.
How do you have any sense for how AISD compares with other school districts? It strikes me that the issues that we've had with the special education state requirements, I'm assuming other school districts are having some similar struggles. Do we know how AISD compares, and is the state being as rigorous in examining other school districts as they have been, or do they only respond to lawsuits on this?
I certainly think that both the corrective action plans would come from parent concerns that are raised directly to TEA was a major driver along with that lawsuit. We know that the lawsuit was a major driver as well. Houston ISD is actually under a similar order to us for special education.
And aren't they largely a charter school district now? Hasn't the state given over this education in Houston ISD to charter operations?
To a gentleman who worked for a charter school, yes, for Mike Miles. It was named the superintendent, and they took over the board. They had some issues also dealing with accountability that we did not. So they had a different action than we did, but most people don't know that their original work with TEA and their original conservator was just on special education. Then they had the accountability issue, and that's when the state took over the whole district. But Houston ISD was under a similar order. We do know that there were lots of districts that were out of compliance with ensuring those timelines, especially coming out of COVID. Because two things happened. One, many districts did not evaluate students during
COVID,
that at-home COVID period, which of course now in retrospect, we would have wished we could have put better systems in place, but how did we know that we would need them? And then more students were actually not, I'm sorry, were referred for special education services following COVID. So we've seen those referral numbers go up. Austin ISD right now is serving about 16% special education, which is fairly high for the state. The state average is about 12, but we are similar to some of our other urban peers. And so it does seem that the urban areas tend to have slightly higher special education numbers.
And that's
kind that of might be because the charters are taking all the kids who are not special
exactly.
ed.
Exactly.
So the percentage is probably similar in our community, but not in our school district.
Well, the line of demarcation usually goes around urban school districts as opposed to our rural school districts. I mean, at the end of the day, the significant problems that we have are places where we also have larger minority populations as well. So there's a direct correlation.
Thank you. Any other comments on this item? I just want to thank the staff of AISD for all the presentations today and our staff, but also just to recognize the really hard work that the AISD board and the administration has put into addressing some really challenging situations, and really appreciate your ability to provide the metrics and really show us the progress that has been made, and hopefully that the students who and the families who are impacted are seeing that too in their experiences in their learning environment. So thank you. If there are no other questions on that, then the last item is kind of just, you know, looking forward to our next meeting. I think we need to determine if it's December 2nd or December 6th, and I guess it's going to be the 6th? Okay. So it's going to be December 6th, our next meeting, from 11:30 to 1:30, and it will be at the AISD location. I've also asked our staff if they can coordinate so that whoever's leading the meeting will send out the agenda and the documents to us by email, as well as having it in the calendar invite. And then if we can work up a little bit better system so that if people are trying to find this committee, we are currently only posting meetings on the host organization. There's not a landing spot for all of the meetings together, which makes it, I think, a little bit challenging for people to follow. And our meetings don't happen kind of with a regular sort of rhythm. So if we can make sure that on all three entities we are posting the dates, and if you don't post, if it's too hard to post the full agenda materials, if you can at least post, we're meeting this day, click here to find the other calendar, I think that would be helpful and make this more transparent for the public and the media who may want to be engaged in the conversations that we are having. And then for the next meeting, we have said that we want to do the executive session. That may take up most of the time. And then I think we would probably want to see if there are any conversations we need to have about either of the Prop A's and what happens in the election. There may be some opportunities to at least understand where different entities can plug in to Prop A implementation for the childcare. That should be a month after. That may be a good touch point. It may be that further conversations offline with staff have to happen, but I think we could perhaps aim for an initial touch point there. Is there anything else that we think we could fit on this agenda?
I think that's a lot of material.
Yeah.
Information, pack too much also.
Okay. Anything else? Edna, did you want to add anything else? Edna, were you trying to add anything else?
I was just going to ask what you all would like on the agenda. And so my understanding is maybe sort of a report on the Prop A results, and then executive session. And then do you also want to discuss who wants to be the one person from each entity on this committee to explore, I think, mm-hmm. Trustee Singh, President Singh?
Yeah, I think you mentioned people can email me.
Yeah, so people can email her, and they can maybe even start before. And so it's not just that I want to report on what happens with Prop A. We're all going to know what that happens.
Exactly.
We want to, like, there's an implementation part where there may be questions or pieces where different entities could be helpful to the county, and trying to understand that. And if that proves to be inappropriate to do at that stage in public session, then we can do just a short report on it, and make sure that those conversations happen in the appropriate places. It's a little hard for me to predict what can happen between November and December, but I think there are certainly conversations that will need to happen about, you know, whether AISD facilities can be used for space, or how to allocate contracted slots that might go to other entities that meet the requirements, so that we can leverage more spaces, et cetera. And I think that may be too early, I don't know. But if it's not too early, having a touch point would be good. If it is too early, then just tell us it's too early.
Thank you.
Too early? Okay.
Well, I'll just say we've been getting briefings from our staff on some of their vision, and I think that it's not unreasonable by December to ask for a little bit more detail about that, or what your thinking is, or kind of what your timetable is. I think we should plan to have an item on our agenda for some kind of an update in December.
I think we, I think we can provide a brief update, but I think it will be too early, just because we're exploring things that our legal team needs to review.
Yeah.
And it might 1 month might be too early.
I got it, but yeah. I just think we should have it on the agenda, so that if there is the opportunity for some kind of an update, it would be valuable.
Right. Yeah.
But I think the bulk of the time should be spent in that, in the legal executive session. And Commissioner Trevelyan is committed to helping you get names of some other folks. And it may be that you have to do it in two parts, so that the outside counsel is in part of it and not in part of it. You'll have to figure that out. And some of it may be there's a portion of it that you share with us that's a history of other actions where they've been successful. But feel free to, I think President Singh has a good idea of what we're looking for, yep. Edna, so she can work it out with you. Great. Well, with that, I will adjourn this meeting at 1:17. If anybody has not had lunch, we still have additional lunches.